Hey you guys, my name is Jasmine. This is my testimony on how I transitioned over into Christianity. So I hope you like it. Please like and subscribe before you get started on watching the rest. So when I was 18, I moved out of my parents' home and I pretty much just wanted to do my own thing. It all started with me having this, it was an old friend of mine that I met in middle school, and we were friends for about, you know, a few years. And I used to go over to her house and help her watch her child while she would go to work. It was literally every once in a blue moon. Like, it wasn't an all the time thing. It was only a few times, actually. But during those few times, her brother will walk past the room and flirt. So I will flirt back and whatever, you know, So so when I did that, we developed liking into each other. And because of that, it led us, you know, to wanting more. We wanted to be in a relationship. I don't think she liked that too much, because I want to say that me and her, our friendship became a little rocky. Like, she used to act a little different. Like, it would get to the point where she would, like, tell me to not come in her room. She would, I would ask her to, like, you know, give me a ride somewhere, and it would be, I wasn't driving at the time, and it would be, no, why can't you walk? Like, it was just stuff, and, you know, like, as a friend, I wouldn't expect that, but, you know, I mean, it is what it is, so. Yeah, it even got to the point one time where I remember her mom mentioned her going somewhere with a friend, and she mentioned she didn't have any. And her mom was like, well, you're not Jazz. She's like, she is not my best friend. And I was like, oh, okay, I guess. So it was like little shots and little attitudes she would have here and there that basically told me, like, yeah, this friendship was over. So when I was living there, yeah, it was weird. It was very weird, because not only was that relationship destroyed, but my relationship with my baby father wasn't good at all either. So, like, it was okay the first few months, obviously. It's how all relationships start off. They start off good, and then, you know, some of them stay good, some of them don't. And mine's was the one who didn't make it. Mine's was the relationship where the true colors were revealed, you know, in the end. So as me and him was together, things were okay. We got into our first argument. He dug his, like, nails into my face real hard, like this, like, dude, and, like, pushed me into the wall and was, like, yelling at me and stuff and whatever, and it left, like, some marks in my face. And I remember I went home and I went to go get some stuff, because I was living there with them. I decided to move in with my boyfriend and his family when I was 18, and I went home to get some things. And when I went home, I remember my dad asked me, is he hitting you? I'm like, no, why you asked me that? He was like, because why do you have marks on your, like, you know, scars on your face? And I told him, like, we was play fighting. We was play fighting, and he got them long nails, et cetera. I just had an excuse. Because I knew if I would have told him that, he would have flipped. So I covered up for him and whatever. And then he told me, like, he said, well, I hope you're not lying to me. He's like, because you know what happens next, right? And I'm like, no, what? And he was like, if somebody's digging in your face like that, eventually they'll start putting your hands on you. I was like, oh, well, you know, I have nothing to worry about. We was, you know, just playing. So I brushed it off, you know. And then when I went back home with his family, I remember we had, like, this debate, I want to say. It was very minor. It was about us moving out and me wanting to establish more things with him, he wasn't ready, of course, to do that yet. So we took our time and I just stayed with him and his family for a little while. And then next thing you know, I found myself to be pregnant with my first son, Braylon. When I got pregnant with Braylon, that's when I noticed a change in his behavior. He started to become distant. He became rude. He would act like I wasn't even there, like I didn't exist. When we would talk about baby names and what I wanted to buy for the baby, and I was just so excited. He would just sit there like literally with a blank face, just looking at me like I was talking to a brick wall. And I was just like, okay, like he's not showing any excitement when it comes to us having this child. But when I first got pregnant, he said he wanted me to keep it. I asked him specifically because I told him I would get an abortion because I personally didn't want to be with somebody that didn't want to be a family. I always wanted to have my child with the man that, you know, was going to marry me. And I would mention that to him too, like, you know, like, when are we getting married? And like, rule number one, ladies, that's the wrong thing to do. You never ask a man when you're getting married, okay? Because a man will come with pure intentions to already want to do that in the first place. But back to what I was saying. So that pretty much happened. And yeah, he just still didn't show no interest. And I want to say every time we would argue, he would get loud, he would get in my face. It got so bad to the point where he started pushing me and throwing me into walls to the point where, like, my body would put a hole in the wall. Like, it'd be like a big hole, like, from, like, my back or butt print, like, pushed into the wall real hard. And, yeah, like, he would push me down to the ground, like, very hard, like, just push me down, like, because he was taller than me. So, like, when I'd be looking up at him, he's looking down at me and we're arguing and he, like, just push me down. And then I try to get back up and he'd just keep pushing me, like, and pushing me. And I'd, like, stop touching me, like, let me go. And he wouldn't let me go. So, by the time I would get up, he'd, like, grab me by my hair and, like, drag me. He used to drag me down the stairs. He also pushed me down the stairs one time while I was pregnant. And I was very hurt by it because I was like shocked at his behavior and how angry he was all the time. And I never did anything to him. I didn't cheat. I never talked to him wrong. I never disrespected him. It was just, I would always complain about him not, you know, being proactive with us buying things for the child before the child gets here, you know? And he would just have attitudes and flip. So, yeah, I remember his mom made him get out that night, and she was, like, pissed at what he did. And I remember when she did let him back in, he did apologize and stuff, and I want to say it slowed down. It slowed down up until I had Braylon. When I had Braylon, we was in the hospital. Everybody was excited. I was excited. And the first words he said to me was, "That's not my child." He looked at Braylon and said, "That's not my child." So I looked up at him. I looked at his mom. I remember she looked at him and told him to hush. She's like, "Please don't start." She's like, "This is your child. He looked just like you." And he said, "Nah, he too light. That ain't my child. He too light." And yeah, like when we got home, he didn't even want to touch him. He didn't want to hold him, nothing. When we was in the hospital, you know how you stay in the hospital for 3 days until they discharge you. He didn't want to hold him then either. He would just sit there and stare and say, "Nah, I'm good." Like, and in my mind, it was like, this is a beautiful moment for me. If you don't want to, you know, take accountability and would you help create it, then you can leave. You don't have to stay here and just stare at our child like he's like he's a disappointment, you know? But I know when we got to the house, he would do the same thing, didn't want to hold him, and it took him about a week. After a week, he finally came into the room and said, let me hold my son. And I was just like, oh, wow, I'm like, this is so weird. Like, this whole relationship is just weird. And I was telling him, like, you gotta change, because if you don't, I'm gonna leave. So after that week, I wanna say he began to like be proactive with him a little more. And I thought there was some potential there. I'm like, okay, well, he's coming along. Maybe he was just getting scared or whatever. I don't know what the case was. But yeah, he came along a little bit. And then I was working, but I wasn't making a lot. Like, I was only bringing in literally like $300 every 2 weeks. And he made more than me while he worked at a factory. And I used to ask him, like, well, you're only giving your mom $200 a week. Why can't you help me get the things Braylon needs? Why do I have to get them all by myself? I'm like, he needs more shoes, he needs more clothes, Pampers and stuff like that. And he just wasn't getting it. He would literally stand in the mirror like this and just brush his hair and ignore me just while I'm talking. And I was just really, really. At that point, I did tell him, I said, if you don't help me with him, I will go put you on child support. I'm like, because I'm not about to do this by myself. I'm like, you said that you wanted me to keep the child and you wanted us to be a family. And then when I have him, you say, oh, he doesn't look like me. And then you come around a week later and act like you love him all of a sudden. And now when I ask you to buy some things that he needs, you're brushing your hair in the mirror like you don't hear me talking to you. So it was really confusing. And I'm like, I was like confused. I'm like, one minute he act like he care, the next minute he don't. And you know, being young, I really didn't know, you know, what love was. So I kept giving him excuses, and it was just it was very frustrating. I felt alone. I feel like I didn't have any help. I didn't want to bother my mom or my dad and ask them to help me come do these things, because I wanted to leave. I wanted to leave on my own and do my own thing. So I felt like I had to be responsible for me. I didn't like asking nobody for help. Yeah, so I remember I did ask his sister. I'm like, could you take me to the store so I could get Braylon some things to me? And she said to me, why can't you walk? And I was like, okay, I can't. It's like, it felt like everybody was against me for, I don't know what, I really don't know. Because everybody that knows me know I'm very kind, I'm very loving, I don't bother anybody. I don't start things. I don't talk bad about people. I just, you know, I pretty much stay to myself. So for her to act that way was confusing. For him to act that way was confusing. The only one who was showing me some love was his mom. She was showing me love. She would care. She would, you know, she would help with Braylon when she could. And, you know, she would just tell me. She'd be like, you need to, you know, leave if it's not working. And she was like, I believe he loves you. She's like, he has a hard time showing it. And I was just like, yeah. I mean, a lot of mothers want to see the good in their child, no matter how bad, you know, they are, no matter what they do. But in my mind, I knew he wasn't as good as she wanted to believe he was. So I did move back with my parents because I was just, you know, I felt alone. I just wanted to go back home. And then he would call, say he was sorry. He wanted me back over. He wanted Braylon back over, and that he missed us and whatever. So I went back and I moved back here. My parents wasn't happy about it at all. They told me I should stay because all I was going to do was come back. And they were right. I was back and forth like at least a good 3 to 4 times because we just kept arguing, and my parents was really just getting tired of it. And I mean, I was tired of it too, but I just, I had this thing in me that was so hopeful and believing that he would change, you know? I didn't realize at the time, yes, potential is good, but if they're not living out that potential, then it's not so good. And that's where I didn't, you know, I wasn't wise in that area at the time. So I was just trying to give him the benefit of the doubt way too many times. And I just knew that eventually this relationship was going to die. It wasn't going to last because he's finding excuses to not be, you know, active. I remember we decided to move, and I was happy. I was very happy. So we moved together. My job cut my hours. I was working at Cleveland Clinic. I was doing valet parking. I already wasn't getting paid that much. So when it cut my hours, I was highly pissed because my checks dropped from like 500 every 2 weeks to like 2 something. Sometimes 1 something. Like, they really cut the hours bad. And he had a good job. He did. He was making like 4 something every week. So he was bringing in about 800-ish every 2 weeks, which is not bad because our rent was only 600 a month. It was frustrating living with him. And I remember we stayed arguing a lot to the point where we wouldn't talk to each other for days at a time. And I remember one time we didn't speak, we didn't text the night before, and he didn't come home in the morning. He worked night shift. So when he didn't come home, I assumed like something was wrong, and I was right. I called his best friend's girlfriend because they worked together, and I asked her, I'm like, did you hear from either one of them? Because he hadn't returned home yet. And she said, oh yeah, she's like, he didn't tell you what happened? I'm like, no, nobody told me what happened. Nobody called me or told me anything. And she said they was in a car accident. So he was hurt pretty bad. I mean, his whole face was split from here to like here, and it was swollen or whatever. But I told him, you know, he was gonna be okay. He was just saying, I'm ugly, like, I'm messed up. My face ain't gonna never be the same. And I'm like, dude, you're fine. It's gonna heal back to normal. Like, stop thinking too much of it. And I'll offer to help him, you know, get in a shower. I'll offer to help him put his clothes on and stuff like that, because I could see he was in pain. Yeah, and I remember I wanted to go over to my friend's house. She stayed in the same apartment complex as us, and I wanted to go across, you know, to get some air, to get out the house, because I never really went anywhere. And I remember him saying that I was cheating on him. He felt like I was going over there to see a guy. And I told her the situation, and she offered to let him come over. So he didn't want to come over. He said, no, I'm good. I don't want to go. And I was like, okay, well, can you at least keep Braylon? I'm like, can I get a break? I need some time. He was like, you can't be long because I'm about to go somewhere in a minute. And I'm just like, in my mind, like, whatever. Like, you're only saying that because I'm going somewhere. Now you've got somewhere to go. Like, what's wrong with you watching your child, you know, for a few hours so I can get some air? And it's like, he really just gave me a hard time any chance he could. And so I left. I went over there. She ended up calling a tattoo guy over, and we ended up getting that tattoo. So it took longer than expected. And I told him he was going to have to hold on because we was getting our tattoos. And I remember he texted me and said, I had to come now because it was an emergency. So I'm like, it's an emergency. I'm like, what's going on? He called me. He said, you need to come now. He's like, something wrong with Braylon. So I'm like, something wrong. I'm like, what's wrong with him? Like, what's going on? I'm like, is he okay? He was like, you need to hurry up. So I ran. We all ran over there, actually. Me, her, and her cousin. And when we got to the door, he answered the door. He opened the door, and I'm like, where's Braylon? I'm like, what's going on? He was like, he good. Exactly how what I just said. He was like, he good, he all right. And I was just like, so why would you say it's an emergency and I just run all the way over here when he's okay? Who does that? And then they looked at me like, bro, like, what's wrong with him? And I'm just like, y'all, I'll see y'all later. I'm like, obviously he's on his bull crap tonight. So when I got in there, I'm like, why would you lie? He was like, who you over there cheating with? What you doing? What you doing? And all this and all that. And I'm not cheating. I'm like, we asked you if you wanted to come over, and you said no. So, I mean, you can't get mad at me when we offered you to come over and sit with us when we get our tattoos and stuff. And he said, no, I ain't trying to hear that. You, she's taking up for you. And I even had the proof of the tattoo on my back, by the way. And he still didn't believe me. So, yeah, he started to get in my face. He literally picked me up in the air and started throwing me into the walls. Like, just bam, bam, like, just throwing me into the walls. And then I started screaming. I started kicking and screaming and telling him to get off of me. And then I started to walk away. When I walked away, he grabbed me by my hair and pushed me down to the ground again. And when he did that, this time I tried to get up. He got on the floor with me and took my head and just banged it real hard to the ground. Yeah, he banged my head real hard to the ground. I was scared because I thought he was going to kill me. And I got up. Everything was blurry. Like, I was like stumbling. Everything was so blurry and I was terrified. So I ran to the bathroom and locked the door. And when I went in there and locked the door, it was a knock on the door. We heard a knock. And when I heard the knock, I unlocked the door and I peeked out and I seen him standing at the door looking through the peephole. And he whispered, it's the police. So they tells me somebody, you know, called because they heard the, you know, commotion that was going on. I was scared. So I did not snitch on him. I did not tell the police what was going on. I just told him we had a minor argument, as all couples do. I told them it was nothing serious, nothing to worry about. I would try to keep it down. And they completely understood and they left. And then after that, I told him I was done and I did not want to be with him anymore. So I went in the room. He said, you sure you want to be done? I'm like, yes. I'm like, because you're not about to keep putting your hands on me. You're not about to keep hurting me and doing these things when I have did nothing to you at all. And we all went to sleep. He went his way, I went my way that night. And when I got up in the morning, everything was cleared out. He had a U-Haul truck outside. And yeah, he was leaving. So then he said, well, he was like, there's no point in me staying because you already said that you don't want us to be together. And I'm like, well, yeah. I'm like, who would want to be with someone that's literally physically hurting them all the time? Don't nobody want to stay in a relationship like that? And he was like, right. He was like, so I'm just get the rest of my stuff and go. He was like, I'm tired of paying bills anyway. He's like, I'm not used to this. We argue all the time. We aren't, you know, getting along. And I'd rather live with my mom. Because I could keep all my money. That was exactly what he said. That's exactly what he said to me. He said he'd rather keep all his money and move back with his mom anyway. Because he's not used to paying bills. So, I was like, all right. So he started getting the rest of his things. Then he started to be petty. And he took the microwave. He took the utensils. He took everything out the house, literally. Only thing we had left was the TV. And I asked him, I said, why would you take the microwave and utensils and stuff? I'm like, you do have a child, and your child still has to eat, despite how you feel about me, despite about us not wanting to be together anymore. The baby has nothing to do with it. And he just walked away. And said not a word. And I just sat there and on the floor watching TV with Braylon, and I was like very hurt. I was so sad, like, and depressed, because it was like, this is your child. For you to hit me the way you hit me, and then take everything and not even care about how your child is going to eat, literally broke my heart into pieces. And yeah, I didn't know what to do at that point. So as a few weeks went on, I tried to look for jobs and I couldn't find anything. So I just called my parents and told them that we wasn't working. I didn't tell them what happened because I didn't want no more drama. And yeah, that wasn't gonna be good. So I just said, no, you should keep that to yourself. So I did that. Yeah, I kept it to myself. And I just told them me and him just wasn't working. So they said that they had helped me move everything out, clean the apartment out and stuff. My mom was at work, so it was really my dad who helped me at the time. But before, let me rewind a little. Before he did, come help me move everything out, I remember one night I was feeling nauseous. And I was like, I just was out of it. I was fatigued and everything. His mom called me and told me, like, her family was over and that they wanted to see Braylon and stuff like that. And I was just like, okay. I'm like, but I don't want to be around him. I'm like, so I don't know. I don't really want to come down there. And she was like, well, I don't know what went on with you two. She's like, but he told me he was cheating on him. And I was just like, what? Like, really? That's what he said? Well, I'm like, let me tell you the truth. Your son was putting his hands on me. And because of that, I told him I didn't want to be with him anymore. It was not because I was cheating on him. I'm like, so I don't know where he's getting that from and why he's lying. And why he won't just be a man about it and tell the truth. And she was just like in shock. And she was like, I did not raise him to be like that. And, all those things. And, and I was like, I mean, I'm sure you didn't raise him to be like that. But that's who he is. That's the guy he turned into. And he can lie all he want to, but that's the truth. That's exactly what he did. And I'm like, he left me and Braylon with nothing up there. And I don't want to see his face. I don't want to be around him. She's like, just come down here and sit in the living room for a little bit with us and I'll take you home. I just want them to see Braylon for a little bit. And I told her, well, I don't know. I'm like, I don't feel good. And I told her the symptoms I was experiencing. And she was like, oh, she was like, that sounds like you're pregnant. And I was like, nah. I'm like, I don't think so. So she was like, I'm going to come up there and get you. She said, I'll take you to the store so you can get a pregnancy test just to make sure. She was like, because it sounds like you are. And I'm like, I don't think I am. But I'm like, I mean, if you want to, I'm like, it's fine. I don't care. So she came. We went to the store. Got the test. When we got to her house, I took the test and it had the plus sign. Yes, unfortunately it had the plus sign. I was very fortunate to have Bryce, but the person I had him with, it was like, unfortunately. So anyway, so I was just basically like, well, I'm not gonna get an abortion. I already thought about doing that with Braylon and I'm glad I didn't. Because I love my son. They bring joy to my life. So I was like, yeah, I'm just going to keep my child and dug it out by myself. So that's what I did. I mean, I moved back in with my parents for a while. And I think up until 8 months, when I got a call. And he was saying he was sorry and that he missed us and he wanted us to be there. And I believed him. Again, I believed him. I believed that he really wanted to change and do right. I did. I don't know why I couldn't just take the red flags for what it was. I was way too hopeful. I just didn't know when to walk away, so I went back. I just had this overwhelming desire to be a family. Like, I never wanted to be a baby mother. I never wanted to, you know, be a single mother. I always wanted to be married to the guy I had kids with. So every chance I could get, I would really try to make it work. And sometimes that's just not the way to go. Like, learn from that. Like, that's not the way to go. Sometimes you have to just let things go and let it be what it be, you know, let it do what it do. You can't hold on to something when it's tearing you down, when it's tearing you down mentally, physically, emotionally. You have to just let go. And I just wasn't there. So yeah, I went back. When I went back, he wasn't putting his hands on me anymore, but he wasn't helping with rice either. Like, he wasn't helping get things for him before his arrival. The only thing he really got throughout our whole relationship was a bassinet. I asked him, can you buy Braylon his first pair of shoes? And his answer was no. And he just got paid that day too. So yeah, it's like him helping me with them, it was not an option. When it came to money, he would not give it to me for them for whatever reason. So, I took him down on child support, and he was pissed about it, but I felt like I had to, because I keep asking you, and I keep trying to give you the benefit of the doubt, but you won't budge. So, I was just like, okay, well, I just gotta do what I gotta do. But back to what I was saying, he wouldn't help with Bryce, so we were still arguing a lot. And I was just like, man, I should never came back, like, because nothing is going right still. And then when I went into labor, he pulled the same thing on me again. He says, he don't look like me. Again. And I was just like, unbelievable. Like, how many times am I going to have to go through this with you? I'm like, I could just go get a DNA test. I'm like, I don't have time for this. I'm like, this is your child. I was not cheating on you. You can stop trying to cover up your lie, because it's not working. I'm like, this is your child. And yeah, so I think he knew it was no way around it, because I want to say when we got discharged, he did gravitate more to Bryce quickly than he did with Braylon. Because with Braylon, like I said, he took like a week before he would hold him or anything. But with Bryce, he did hold him when we, you know, when we got there, he held him and everything and bonded with him. But we were still arguing a lot. Yeah, we were. So because of that, I developed an anxiety. Yeah, I didn't know what it was at first, but I remember one night, I was so mad. We were arguing, and then Braylon was doing stuff, so I started yelling at Braylon, like, to go sit down. Then I went upstairs to go, you know, just take a breath, because I was so overwhelmed. And I just sat down, gave Braylon his blankie. He lay down in the bed, and I was watching TV sitting on the edge of the bed. And the next thing you know, I just felt this sudden feeling of, like, this intense feeling of doom just took over me. And I was like, something bad is about to happen. And then my heart started beating like very fast out of nowhere. I also got a little lightheaded, and I was hyperventilating. Like, I was just, oh my God. Like, I can't breathe, I can't breathe. Like, something is wrong. I ran downstairs as fast as I could, and I told her, like, I can't breathe. Like, help, please call the ambulance, because something's not right. My heart is beating fast. And she was like, oh God. She was like, and then she called the ambulance. So when she called them, she was on the phone talking to them. And they, you know, it was guiding her through what to do and stuff to keep me calm until they arrived. So we just waited until they came. And when they came, my heart was beating at 140. So they put me on a regular ambulance truck, and I went to the hospital. They ran tests, they did some, you know, the vital checks and everything. everything came back normal, so they didn't understand what was going on. And I went back like at least a good 2 to 3 times. And they just kept saying they can't find anything. So I was starting to get confused. I thought it was something wrong with my heart. I didn't know what was going on. So I had it one more time. One day, I was coming out the bedroom, and it started because me and him started arguing. My heart started beating real fast, and I noticed it wouldn't slow down. So I started breathing harder, and I'm like, something is wrong. I'm like, I don't know what's wrong, but something is wrong with me. And he just looked at me and went up the stairs. While I was having a hard time breathing, he looked at me and just went up the stairs. And that was it. And I remember his mom came up the steps while I was standing there, and she was like, what's wrong with you? Like, you're breathing hard. And I was like, I don't know. I'm like, my heart is beating fast again. I feel like I can't breathe. I feel like I'm about to faint. And she was like, she called the ambulance again. And this time when she called them, I woke up. I knew at that moment when I told him I couldn't breathe, and he walked away and went upstairs as if it didn't matter that I couldn't breathe. I knew it was time to go. If you're in a relationship with someone and you're telling them you can't breathe, you're telling them something is wrong with you, and they walk away. You just walk away. At that point, you're like evil. You don't even care if I was to lay here and die. It's basically what you're telling me if you walk away and let somebody have a hard time breathing. You don't know what's wrong. I could be having a heart attack. I could be having anything. I didn't even know what was wrong. So I knew it was time to get out that relationship because that man didn't care. He didn't care if I was having a hard time breathing or not. He just didn't care. It's like it was to the point where he was like, I could care less if you were even alive. It's basically what he said in so many words. Because I would have never walk away from somebody who's having a hard time breathing. I would sit there and wait with them until the ambulance arrived. But he didn't. So when I got to the hospital, my parents came up there. And my dad was sitting at the edge of the bed. He said, you need to come home. He said, you need to come home. And I said, yeah, I am. Because I was tired. And I couldn't believe that the person that I had 2 kids with, the person I trusted, did so much to me and said he was going to change so many times just to only walk away from me the moment I needed him the most, the moment where I couldn't even breathe, catch my breath, the moment I felt like I was going to die or something because my heart was beating fast. He walked away and left me there. I was so hurt. I was real hurt. And when I got out the hospital, I did, as I said, I moved with my parents and I never looked back. I never got back into a relationship with him because I just woke up. I knew that he didn't care about my life. And it's sad that it took so long, you know? It should have never took so long for me to see that that man didn't care about me or the kids. Because you don't leave the kids in the house by themselves with nothing to eat. And you don't walk away from somebody when they say they can't breathe. So I just chalked it up and said it is what it is. Now, when I did get home, I continued to have anxiety attacks, but I didn't know that that's what there were. I just kept having a hard time breathing. My parents had to call the ambulance a couple more times, and they eventually said, this is like your fifth time coming here with the same issue. And the lady asked me on the truck, she said, are you stressed about anything? And I was like, yeah. I'm like, I'm stressed about a lot, actually. And she was like, okay. She's like, you know what I think it is? I think you're having panic attacks. And she's like, because they ran so many tests, they did all that they can do, and there's nothing wrong with your heart. Your heart is healthy. I was like, so the only thing that makes sense is that you're having panic attacks. And I'm like, what is that? And she explained to me what it was and everything. And they told me to, you know, contact my physician. And when I did that, they put me on medicine. I was taking, what was the medicine called? I was taking Xanax to help keep me calm. And I was like, it was terrifying. I didn't like the feeling. The Xanax did help. It would keep me calm for a while. It would help keep my heart from, you know, racing real fast. But my dad did talk to me, and he told me, like, you need to find a different way to deal with what you're going through. He's like, I want you to stay on medication forever. He's like, because eventually you're going to keep upping your dose. And it's not good, you know, to stay on something that strong and keep upping that dose like that. So I was just like, yeah, you're right. So I would do some research on anxiety and what to do with panic attacks. It got so bad to the point where I couldn't even go in a grocery store. I couldn't even leave a house without panicking. Like, I would just, as soon as I would get in the store, it's like it'd be so many people walking my way, and I would just get overwhelmed, and I just have to leave. I would literally have to leave, like, right away. It's like, it was weird. And because of that, I was out of work for like 7 months. It was literally 7 months. I was out of work for 7 months straight. I couldn't work. I couldn't go anywhere, because every time I would leave the house, every time I would step foot into a store, I would automatically just have a panic attack. And all of this came from stress from a relationship. I didn't understand how stress can really affect you. Stress can really affect you. It can kill you. Stress can really kill you. It can do things to your body and cause problems, because anxiety and panic attacks are not good. You can, prolonged anxiety and panic attacks can eventually turn into strokes. It can turn into a real heart attack and so many other things, because it's messing with the heart. The heart is out of whack now. Now I don't even have a regular, the pattern, my heart pattern was irregular. It was just up and down, and it would flutter so much because of panic attacks. And I don't know, I got so scared one night when I jumped up out of my sleep from a panic attack. I cried out to God, and I cried, and I was rocking back and forth, and I was just like, God, please. I'm like, if you hear me, take this away. Take away my anxiety. I don't want it. I just want you to heal me. I said, please take away my anxiety. I'm like, I'm tired. I'm scared. And I was just rocking back and forth, rocking back and forth. And I remember I literally cried myself to sleep. And I woke up the next morning, and I noticed at the end of the day, I went without my first panic attack. And I knew it was nothing but God, because I had them every day, every day. And not only did I go without it that day, I went without it for a whole week. I didn't have an attack for a whole week. And I knew it was nothing but the peace of God that, you know, he comforted me that night. He heard my cry. He heard my prayer. And he comforted me. And that moment, I've always heard about God. I always know about God. I went to church, but I didn't have a relationship with him. So in that moment, I decided when I went back to church that I wanted to give my life to Christ. And so I walked up to the altar and I got saved. And I gave my life to Christ. I did. I gave my life to Christ, and it was the best thing I ever did. It was the best thing I ever did. Ever since then, I haven't had any anxiety or panic attacks. I've did so well. I was able to get off of it without the medication, and I knew it was nothing but God. Because in reality, you don't just wake up and stop having anxiety attacks when you've had them for 7 months straight. In most cases, it would take time, you know, to start to decrease. But in my case, it went away after the day I prayed. It went away, and I knew it was nothing but God. Yeah, so that was part one. Yes, part one of my testimony. I will be making part two, because in part two, it goes into what happens when you backslide. Because I did. I was one of the Christians, you know, who got saved and I fell. And I want to talk about that story to share with, you know, women what happens when you give your life to Christ and then, you know, step away from him. And you say you're going to live for him and you literally, like, just start doing your own thing again. It's a danger that comes with that. And I want to share that story with you guys because that story has also changed my life in a tremendous way. So yes, if you stayed this far, thank you so much for watching. I hope you are encouraged. If you are in an abusive relationship, please get out now. Do not stay. Love does not hurt. It will not hurt you. Love might be disappointing at times. It can't, because nobody is perfect. But love will not physically harm you. It will not. So I just want to encourage any woman that is going through any type of abuse, whether it's physically, emotionally, sexually, seek help and don't keep waiting, because it can get worse. It will get worse. So yeah, like and subscribe and stay tuned for part two. Thank you.